So if you have your Bible with you, please take it out. I always encourage you guys to bring your own Bible. So if you do, please take it out. And we'll turn to Genesis 1, chapter 1, verse 1. Easiest passage to find, right? Genesis 1, 1. Let's all read it together. One voices. Here we go. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Amen. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. It's the very first word in the Bible. The very first verse. It tells us so much. What does it tell us? That in the beginning, right? Who? God. Did what? Created the heavens and the earth. It tells us that everything that we see, we do, we touch, everything around here in this world is created by whom? God. God created everything. So every creature you see, everything that we touch, clocks, mics, sound systems, everything, it all came from that verse. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Everything is created by God. We have a creator, God, and he has a purpose for his creation. Everything has a purpose. You see the car out there? What's the purpose of that car? Transportation for whom? For us, right? For us to live a better life, more efficient life. Everything, like the food, why is it there? For us to feed us, for us to eat and grow, right? To be healthy. Everything in this world has. And that, the verse in Genesis 1:1, explains why everything exists. And Genesis 1:1 also tells us that the space, the time, the cosmos, the universe, we live in that universe, right? That God created in that time. So ever since he created the heavens and the earth, we're right now in his time. What do you say? His cosmos, his universe, right? Last week, past week, the pastors in Grace Community Church, all the pastors, went to the retreat on the Keats Island. It's just one of the islands out there. It's beautiful. Like, you get to see all these, like, ocean, mountains. I loved it. It was, we had a good time, right? And there at the retreat, I was meditating on Genesis 1, chapter 1, the whole chapter. Right? So I was just reading it, meditating it, and there was one observation I found from the passage. I was reading it and I was like, hey, God created everything in order, in a sequence. He didn't create all things at once. There was order in his creation. So this is the days of his creation. So on the first day, what did he do? He separated the darkness from the light. He told, hey, darkness, you stay on this side. Light, you stay on this side. He made order. The next day, he divided the water from above or on the ground. That was the day two. Day three, he created land and divided it from the water. And vegetation was created on the third day. That's the make part. And then he moves on. On the fourth day, there was a sun, moon, stars, and he filled the sky. He began to fill his creation, right? The heavens. Day five, he created the creatures to fill the sky and the water. Day six, creatures to fill the land. And man, the pinnacle of his creation, was created on the day sixth. And then he rested on day seventh. Just remember this. that he had created, he made the world first 3 days, and he began to fill it, and he rested on the last day. So, I have a question for you. Do you guys have a favorite Disney movie? For me, growing up, well, see, there's a generational gap here, right? I don't know Coco, but do you guys know Lion King? Oh, okay, thank you. Oh, you guys scared me with Coco. Okay, so you guys do know Lion King, right? Which one, though? There are like first one, the second. Is there a third one? There's only two, right? Well, I don't know. I only watched the first one, so I'm just going to talk about the first one. So, well, growing up, Lion King was my favorite movie and still is. I love the story. The plot is strong. It's got, you know, ups and downs, you know. It's got everything. I love it.
Look, Simba, everything the light touches is our kingdom.
Wow.
A king's time as ruler rises and falls like the sun. One day, Simba, the sun will set on my time here and will rise with you as the new king.
And this will all be mine?
Everything.
Everything the light touches. What about that shadowy place?
That's beyond our borders. You must never go there, Simba.
But I thought a king can do whatever he wants.
Oh, there's more to being king than getting your way all the time.
There's more?
Simba. Everything you see exists together in a delicate balance. As king, you need to understand that balance and respect all the creatures, from the crawling ant to the leaping antelope.
But Dad, don't we eat the antelope?
Yes, Simba, but let me explain. When we die, our bodies become the grass, and the antelope eat the grass. And so, we are all connected in the great circle of life.
I love the movie. It's got so many messages, right? And what you guys just see is the Mufasa talking to his son, Simba. And he tells his son, hey, in this world, there's limit to my life, right? Soon, my time will be over and your time is going to come. You will be the next king. Grade sevens. Soon, new grade sevens are going to come. And you guys will be opas and nunas, right? And grade 12s, soon you'll become a college or young adults, right? You'll move on. We all move on. That's how God created this world. That's the order of his creation. We all age. The time goes. Even if you want it or not, we all grow old. And there's another thing that I wanted to talk about in this clip. Mufasa says, hey, in this circle of life, we, the lions, eat the antelopes, right? But then when we die, we become the grass, and they eat the grass. That's the circle of life. That's what Mufasa teaches his son. In this world that God created, guys, there's order, and there's stages of life. God doesn't work, you know. Hey, now I'm here. I will jump the next two stages and make something. No. First step, step by step, he created. Day one, he divided the light from the darkness. Day two, he divided the water from above or from the ground. Think about this. If God did not create the land, but created the lions first, what would happen? Can they even exist? If God didn't create other creatures, other plants, or the water in the world, and then created us humans or the lions, can they still exist? No. You know what God's speaking here in this passage, in his creation, is that everything God does, there's order. He works in orderly manner. Last week, when I was away for the retreat, my baby boy, my friend, Ian, he flipped for the first time. But I missed it. But my wife had a video. It's so much fun, like, watching him grow, right? From the baby stage to next stage, he began to mumble, like, blah, 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 right? And finally, he flipped. I just can't wait until he speaks something, right? He's like, daddy, 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 right? That was the last week. But imagine, guys, what if there was no growth? There was no order, the sequence. What if just Ian came out and then he's like, hey, dad, do you want to see flip? And then he flips all over. Can you guys imagine? He's like, he plays with me. Like, he's like, dad, can I make a funny faces? And he like plays with me, like toys with me. It's weird, right? I'd be scared, right? Hey, you're my son. What are you doing? That's how God created this world, guys. For the babies, they have the baby stage. And then they grow a little. They begin to, you know, mumble. And now they flip. And in some days, they can sit by their own, on their own. And soon, he will speak something and be able to walk. Different stages. You have to be able to sit first for you to stand. You can't just lay down and then just go straight to walking, right? There's different stages. That means you have the muscle has to grow. Be ready. If you want to move on, your previous stage must be ready and be done. For there to be a lion, there needs to be a plant. Other animals. And for there to be a land, there needs to be a world, earth. Step by step, God created the heavens and the earth and his creatures. This is the order of God. When I see, hey, you know what? Let's turn to Matthew chapter 1. If you have your Bible, we go to the first chapter of Old Testament. Now we'll move on to the first chapter of the New Testament. Easy today. Matthew chapter 1. I don't have it up here, so if you can just look. First chapter of the New Testament. So, what's it about? It's the genealogy of Jesus, right? Matthew chapter 1 is all about genealogy of Jesus. How Jesus came to this world. From Abraham to all the way to Jesus, right? It says, this is the genealogy of Jesus. And I was reading it. I'm like, hey, why is Jesus like, why do we have to wait for Jesus so long? Why can't Jesus be a son of Abraham, right? Or a son of David? Or why can't he be like a son of Boaz or something? There's so many, I felt like there's so many unnecessary names, God. Why do we have to wait so long? If Jesus comes, God, like, doesn't that solve everything? Why did you send Jesus so late? I'm like, Jesus, can you come already? If you read through the genealogies, there's so many stories hidden behind. Like, stories of Abraham, Isaac, right? But as I was reading it and just talking, like meditating on it, God was speaking to me. He's like, Phil, you know what Israel had to go through? All these exiles, all these wars of people. Jesus came at the right timing, the perfect timing that I planned, that I intended. All the history of Israel was necessary for both you and for the people and for God. He came at the right, the perfect timing. Even though all these exiles was hard and tough, the wars, the death. There were so many stories, right? Good and bad. But hey, everything, all the history of Israel, I know. And I sent Jesus Christ at the right time, the perfect timing that I intended to. That's how God works. He doesn't jump. He doesn't skip stages. He goes step by step by step by step by step, one by one. I talk to Pastor Josh a lot. We're like the best friends. We sit together in the office. And Pastor Josh and I, when I think about you guys and the youth in general, we're worried because a lot of youth came to me or Josh lately and says like they're struggling with their faith. I'm like, then we ask, why? Why are you so struggling? What's your problem? They're like, hey, I'm so busy. I do this, I do this. I have like schoolwork. I have like other volunteers. And I have to work and make more money, right? And I was hearing it. And I was just praying about it, right? I do pray for you guys. Hopefully you guys do know that, right? But, and I was just thinking, what'll be their problem? I think because a lot of youth kids, a lot of you guys, try to get ahead in your life and try to do things that at your stage shouldn't do. You guys try to jump over some stages and try to become an adult. You guys try to make a lot of money. But as a student, I was thinking, hey, is that a right thing? Aren't you guys skipping something? As a student, your primary goal and focus should be school, not work. If you're not doing well in school, but you're working your butt off, hey, you need to think about your life. The order, there's something wrong with the order. And even if you're not working, and you're working your butt off, and you're still struggling with your faith, hey, then your school shouldn't be primary focus. As a Christian, before a student, before being a student, we are all Christians. We're all sons and daughters of God. And as Christians, you need to focus on your faith life. The Word of God. Prayer. If you skip that and focus on school, hey, there's something wrong. It's like having a lion without the land. It's like having a creature without water. Relationships. You guys love to, you know, date, right? Boyfriends, girlfriends, I understand. I met my wife at, well, almost grade 12, right? Your age. But you know what I did? I prayed for a whole year to God, what is a perfect, well, not perfect, but what's the best way to date at my age, at my stage in life? What is it? You see, when I see you guys date, I'm worried because a lot of people your age dating, going out. You guys try to act like an adult. Skip a stage and be like adult. You guys try to do things that only the adults can do. Hey, as a youth student, as an image of God, guys, you guys need to pray and ask and discern. God, what is my role at this time, right now, as a grade 7, grade 8, grade 9, grade 10s, grade 11s, 12s? God, what should I focus on in my life? As sons and daughters of God, God, how should we live? What's the best way to live? How do I organize your life? If your life is aligned with God's will for you, for me, for other people. Because if you skip that stage and try to be like adults, you'll lose your faith. I'm sure you will lose your faith. You'll struggle because you're not there yet. You're not there yet. You need to be here. You need to be here and work on your stuff as youth, as a student, as Christians. Without learning this, without readying yourselves first, if you move on, you'll get hurt. If there's no land, the creatures can't live. If you don't have foundation here first and move on with your relationship, you'll get hurt. If you don't find yourselves here first and try to be successful, work, make money, I'm sorry, you'll get hurt. Because you're moving, you're going too fast. God could have created everything in 1 second. Psh! And we could have been here in this place, but he didn't. He created everything by step, by step, by step. I don't know how long it'll take in your stage and for readying yourselves. Well, it took 100 years for Jesus to come to this world, right? Wait until the perfect timing. Ready yourselves. Pray and ask God, God, what's my job here as a student right now? Ready yourselves with the word of God. And when the time comes, He'll help you move on to the next stage of your life. Because he's there with you. He knows what you're going through right now. Are you aligned with God? Is your life aligned with his created creation order?